Hello students, today we are going to start chapter 1, beginning of the modern India. This is your history chapter. Time frame of period. You know the modern period in India, it extends roughly from middle of 18th century to present time. Middle of 18th century to present time is your modern period. This period covers history of only about 250 years. So this middle of 18th century to present time, it covers history of 250 years. Revolutionary changes took place during this period, not only in India, but other parts of the world also. So this period saw revolution in USA, France, Russia and China, unification of Italy and Germany, imperialism. Means rule by an emperor. Colonialism means the policy or practice of acquiring full or partial control over another country. It is a policy of acquiring the full or the partial control over another country, like England was having in India. And two world wars. This period is also important, means significant, to Indian people as they awoke to their right to freedom. The Indian people, they awoke, they fight for their right to freedom. They strove for freedom, means a lot of struggle is there for the freedom. Because of that struggle and the Indians were united, India finally became independent in 1947. But these 200 years were of turmoil, means great disturbance, tribulation, means great trouble and sufferings. These 200 years were of turmoil, great disturbance, tribulation, great trouble and sufferings. Why are dates important? The idea is problematic because historians cannot reach a consensus. Consensus means historians have not reached to any agreement as which are the important dates. So idea is problematic right now because historians also have not reached to an agreement that which are the important dates. The discussion of which are the most significant event is more interesting and worthwhile enterprise than forcing people to memorize dates and events. So there is a discussion going on. The discussion should be done of the which are the important events. That is an interesting fact. That is worthwhile also. Rather than you should not force people to memorize dates and events. You should make it more interesting, more worthwhile, which are the important dates and which event took place on that date. Chronology is the key concept of the disciple of history. Chronology means which time period that thing has occurred, that event has occurred. It can help provide part of structure for children to make sense of the past, but only if they have some real understanding of the events attached to the dates. I told you, rather than cramming the things, rather than forcing the children to memorize the dates and events, the children should be informed in an interesting way that which event took place on which date. In an interesting way, discussion should be done in the class. So that's why it is more understanding of the events. The child can have a real understanding of the events attached to the dates and the child can easily memorize it. So like memorizing dates for history test. So you should draw timeline first. Which event took place first, then after that which event. Make a timeline, okay, in a chronological order. Like 1917 Russian Revolution, World War II starts 1939, Cold War starts 1947, first man in space 1961, first man on moon 1969, end of Cold War 1989, so financial crisis in 2007 and 2008. So whatever the big events are there, first learn that. Okay, whatever the big events are there, first learn them, then learn the small events. If you know the general course of events, it is very easy to organize them in details and to memorize them also. It is possible that a few students nowadays can recite the name of the king, queens and their dates. They can easily recite it. But history is definitely about the changes that has occurred in the past. Means that the changes which have occurred over time. The concept of time and changes are central to history. These concepts of time are central to history. So it is very important for a history teacher that to make the subject more interesting, that students are engaged. The students should be persuaded to believe in the importance and relevance of the history in the present and the future. Because if you don't know about the history, you cannot do the things in the present and you cannot control your future. So it is very important to know about the past, that you can have a better understanding of the present and you can control your future. Time in history is measured through conventional system of dates, and the importance of dates is that they allow students to order the post events and process in terms of sequence and duration. I told you this only, how to memorize the dates, draw a timeline. This only they are telling them, that a conventional system of dates and the importance of dates should be told to the students, that they should post the events in the sequence and the duration they occurred. History is important not for the sake of nostalgia. Nostalgia means a feeling of pleasure and little bit of sadness also, but for understanding the cause behind the events. Means a child should understand the cause why the event occurred, then it is easy to memorize the date also. It is not that you are teaching children just name, dates and places. It is no way to help them. They should understand the idea. They should have an agreement that history is shaped by philosophy, whether it is a good or a bad. So we need to show them the connective links of the events, connective links in the dates of the histories, that they can have knowledge, that they're easy to learn. Okay. How do we choose dates? A date becomes important if the event associated with it significant in some way for us. So a date is very important to us if the event occur on that day is very important to us. The choice of the dates in history has always been subjective, depending on what issue the historian wanted to focus on, what slant he want to give to an issue. That is the choice of the dates. So if I give you an example, the British, they wanted their conquest of India. They wanted to control the India. Their administrative policies, their achievements should be the focus of history of the modern India. These things should be there. So if I want to choose the date, I should begin with the rules of the first Governor General. The first Governor General of India was Warren Hastings. He came in 1773. Okay, so if I want to choose the dates, I'll choose like this. First, Governor General, General Warren Hastings. He came in 1773. Then, the end, means the last viceroy, was Lord Mountbatten in 1947. So, as an agreement, if I know about Indian history, it was divided into three parts: Hindu, Muslim, and British. So, Indian history was divided into three periods: Hindu, Muslim and British. This kind of division was done by a Scottish economist and political philosopher, James Stuart Mill. He was the one who divided the Indian history into three periods: Hindu, Muslim, British. James Stuart Mill, Scottish economist and a political philosopher. In 1817, he divided Indian history into three periods. It continued to be accepted like this only, Hindu, Muslim and British, till India became independent. Now, Indian history has been divided into three periods: ancient, medieval and modern. So this division has its problems. It is a periodization that borrowed from the West. So this division too has its problem. It is the periodization that has borrowed from the West. The modern period has been associated with growth of all forces of modernity. Means the modern period is associated with the growth of science, reason, democracy, liberty, equality. Many historians referred this period as a colonial period. You know, the colonial period, because Britishers were controlling India. They were ruling India at that time. So this period describes as in the books under the science, reason, democracy, liberty, equality. So if I talk about medieval, it was a term used to describe the society where features of modern society did not exist. Medievals means middle period. Okay. It does not include the features of the modern society. As India was under British rule, people did not have equality, freedom and liberty at that time. So this period was colonial period. Many historians believe this medieval period was a colonial period. This is the picture of Warren Hastings, your first governor general. What is colonialism? Colonialism is the extension of nation sovereignty over territory beyond its border by the establishment of either settler colonies in which indigenous population are directly ruled or displaced. Simple sense, they are telling that the nation sovereignty means the supreme control of the nation, it goes beyond the border, means somebody else or some other country is ruling the another country. They settle their colonies in that particular place, they rule the native people. Indigenous means the native population who are living over there, they are ruled by them or displaced by them. So likewise, I can give you example over here, like Britishers, they were ruling India at that times. So the nation sovereignty, extension of the nation sovereignty, means supreme power went to Britishers. They were controlling the territories. They were settling the colonies over here. The indigenous, the native population, means the Indians are directly ruled by them or displaced by them. It is very essential to have a system of direct political, economic and cultural intervention and hegemony by power control, means powerful control over a weaker one. Hegemony means this one only, that dominance of one group over the another. So colonizing nations generally dominate the resources. If colonies have been developed, colonialism is there, then they dominate the resources, labor, market of the colonial territory. It also imposes, means the country who is ruling over the another country, they impose their social culture, their religious, their linguistic means structures on the native people. Like the Britishers were ruling India, they imposed their social culture, their religious structure, their linguistic structures on the indigenous population, means of the native people who are living in India. Sources of information, administrative records were important source of information. So administrative records means the spread of education. It inspired the people that they should write and they should have a rich treasure of the documents. Printing press was invented. So great growth of the production of the books, magazines, newspaper, journals were done at that time. So this provide the basis what happened during a particular time. So we are having administrative written records because printing was being invented at that time, and we are having books, magazines, newspaper, journals which tell us about the particular time. We are having literary sources also about individual have written about it, as well as government records of the British administration. The British believed that the act of writing was very important, means you should write everything, you should have each and every record, every instruction, investigation, plan and policy had to be clearly written down. This was the thinking of the Britishers, and it is very important also to write every instruction, investigation, plan, policy. This methodology produced important memos, notings
and reports. Like Britishers, they used to write, investigate, plan, policy, everything should be in written. So this method helped in writing the memos, notings and reports. British also felt that there is a need of preserving the important documents and letter. So they started making a record room. Okay, for all the important documents and letter, they go to the record room. The village tehsildar office, the collectorate, the commissioner office and the law court, they all were having their record rooms and all the documents and letters were going into that particular room. Museums and archives were also established to preserve the important records. So Britishers, they developed museum also, archives also, to preserve all the important records.
So newspapers are another important literary source. They are very important as they capture the spirit of the time, because newspapers are having date, so they capture the spirit of the time, means at that date or that particular year what happened. So newspaper carry news, cartoons, letter, editorials and even advertisements. Many newspapers have kept their old editions in the form of microfilms in archives. I'll tell you what is archives. In the National Archives of India, built in the 1920s, there are innumerable documents. So if I talk about, I was talking about archives. So National Archives of India, built in 1920, they are having innumerable documents that is available for the period under study. Actual proceeding of the meetings of government officials, the diaries of the officials, their letters, the eyewitnesses account, means whatever eyewitnesses observed, the records of the court proceedings, everything is being preserved. So the National Archives of India is a space of preserving and protecting all these invaluable records and uses the scientific methods of preservation. So National Archives of India, they are having everything, means every proceeding of the meeting of the government officials, the diaries of the officials, their letters, the eyewitnesses, whatever they observed, their accounts, records of the court proceedings. So these all things are preserved and protected under the National Archives of India. And they are using scientific methods for the preservation. National Museum in New Delhi has preserved many coins, paintings, weapons, jewelry and other artifacts of that period. So National Museum in New Delhi, they have preserved coins, paintings, weapons, jewelry and other artifacts. This is the picture of National Archives of India, where every document, your diaries of the officials, means eyewitnesses, records, everything is being preserved. Sources of information. We are doing the same topic again. When New Delhi was built, the National Museum and the National Archives were both located close to the Viceregal Palace. The location reflects the importance of these institutions. So these both the institutions were located close to Viceregal Palace because these both are important institutions. The Salar Jung Museum, it is in Hyderabad. It has collection of 43,000 art objects and 50,000 books and manuscripts, writing with the help of, means writing on the palm leaf or on the parchments, means animal skin or on the bark of the tree. That is your manuscript. Manu means hand. So the collection includes Indian art, European art, children's art and a rare manuscript section. So the Salar Jung Museum in Hyderabad, 43,000 art objects, 50,000 books and manuscripts. They are having Indian art, European art, children's art and rare manuscript section. This is your National Museum, New Delhi. Salar Jung Museum in Hyderabad. Surveying and mapping. Beside literary sources, maps, photographs, paintings and statues also constitute an important part of sources. These are also important part of sources. Surveying became a common practice under the colonial administration. When Britishers were ruling,
they used to survey into different places. They go for survey over there. The country had to be properly known before it could be effectively administered. If you want to control the country, if you want to effectively administer the country, you should know about the country. So the Britishers start surveying about country India. The Survey of India was set up, which made detailed map of towns, villages, mountains and coast. So the Survey of India was established and they made a detailed map of towns, villages, mountain and coast. Underline the first survey general. The first surveyor general of India. The first surveyor general of India was appointed in 1815. He was appointed in 1815. In 1821, H.W. Voysey made the map of Hyderabad region. 1821, H.W. Voysey made the map of the Hyderabad region. This was the first proper geological map made in India. First proper geological map. Year 1851, here the Geological Survey of India established in 1851. Geological Survey of India established. It started with the survey of Himalayan ranges between the river Ganga and Ravi. Okay, the Geological Survey of India starts its survey with the Himalayan region between the river Ravi and the Ganga. British also took elaborated steps to make map the coastal areas as these were to be their new settlements. So they started making maps of the coastal areas because these places were now to be their new settlements. By the early 19th century, surveys were being carried out to map the entire country. Means till the early 19th century, survey which they are doing, this is only done to for the map, to carry out the map, to make the map of the entire country. If I talk about villages, revenue surveys were conducted, that how the revenue is being generated over there. The purpose was to know about the quality of the soil, the cropping pattern, the topography. Topography means somewhere plateau is there, somewhere island, somewhere mountain, somewhere plains area are there. So this revenue survey were conducted to know about the quality of soil, the cropping pattern, the topography. 1871, Indian census was first comprehensive census of India. In 1871, Indian census was the first comprehensive census of India at that time. The census has been held every 10 years following. After every 10 years, the census of India is being done. It presents its data. 15th national census held in 2011. After 10 years, mean 2021, this year, the 16th national census will be there. The first modern census of India was conducted in 1881. The census of India, they help us in creating a detailed records of the people in all the provinces of India. Census of India collects the data about the population of the country, population of India. So first census was done in 1881. First census was done in 1881. First census 1881. And now in 2021, it will be 16th national census, because 15th was done in 2011. After 10 years, mean 2021, it will be 16th national census. Census tell us about the population of the country. They help us in preparing detailed records of the people living in the different provinces of India. Beside revenue surveys, revenue survey was conducted. Many other surveys were also done by the Britishers all over India. Botanical survey, geological survey, archaeological survey, forest survey. So these surveys were done at that time also, and nowadays also these surveys are being done. Official records. These records tell us about what officials thought, what they were interested in, what they wished to preserve for prosperity. It is PROSPERITY, prosperity. So the record tell us about what the officials thought, what they were interested in, what they wished to preserve. These records do not tell us about what other people in the country felt. Okay, they don't tell us about the other people or what are their actions. These are the other sources
which we find in plenty. There are diaries of the people, accounts of the travelers, autobiographies, magazines, and journals that tell us about the thinking of the people. These are the official records. These were the biographies, such as that of Gandhi. Biography was written by William Shire. William Shire was a person who spent a lot of time with Gandhiji during Dandi March. Rashundri Devi, she was the first woman to write the autobiography. I'll tell you the name of the autobiography was Amar Jeevan. The name of the autobiography of Rashundri Devi was Amar Jeevan. It tells us about the status of women in the 19th century. And this autobiography, it was written in Bengali language. There are many short stories, novels that reflect the times in which they were being written. There are hundreds of travelers that have ace accounts. So means there are hundreds of travelers accounts. It is accounts. Sarat Chandra Chatterjee, he was the person, and Prem Chandra, he wrote about peasants, means farmers, and downtrodden. Downtrodden were the persons who were treated very badly. So Prem Chandra and Sarat Chandra Chatterjee, they wrote about the peasants and downtrodden people who are treated badly. The play Neel Darpan, it was written by Dinabandhu Mitra, was based on the exploitation of workers' plantation. Exploitation means selfish, somebody is taking advantage of the another person. That is exploitation. So the Neel Darpan play, it was written by Dinabandhu Mitra. It was based on the exploitation of workers' plantation. Means plantation workers, how they were exploited. Many books were written on history of India by Winsett Smith. For the first time, books on the economic history of India were written in this period. For the first time in India, the economic history, means books on economic history, were written. Many newspapers were published in India, not only in English, but also in Tamil, Gujarati, Bengali, Urdu, Persian. These were also the languages in which the newspaper was written. The most famous newspaper was Kesari, Bal Gangadhar Tilak Kesari, and Mirat ul Akbar newspaper of Raja Ram Mohan Roy. So these were the two famous newspapers published during this period. These are the photo of Sarat Chandra Chatterjee and Munshi Premchandra. Thank you and have a nice day.